Afternoon, colleagues. How are you? Good, good. I can't compete with food, colleagues, so you better bear with me, right? Sizwe Gwala is the name. Absa Bank is my home, the only bank in the world, right? Unless it's red, don't trust the bank. Remember that, right? If it's not red, you don't trust it, right? So today we'll be talking about a couple of issues that I want us to, you know, tackle. Professionally, I'm currently the head of data governance. I always say that before that, I was a very weird guy doing information security, looking into systems, working for our government, starting from the province in KZN. I came to national offices. Then ultimately, I moved to the Latin American region, looking at Venezuela, Uruguay, Paraguay, Brazil, and but that region. So our role was simply to ensure that when we deploy a mission or an embassy, one, we need to understand the host country agreement as to what exactly we can bring and what we can't bring. Two, we secure our pipeline from this side right across. So we had very, very, very strict encryptions that we were running there. And of course, I was part of the state security agency, so the core business, we had to create a passage for our guys, right? That no one will see. So that's what we did. It was quite an interesting time until ultimately I moved to the private sector, and I've been in data management since then, which it's something that is key. So colleagues, I just want us to look at a couple of issues, right? But I thought people will be back now, because I want us to talk about music, just lightly, right? Briefly about music. I did this exercise in another conference, and they really liked it, right? So I want to play a song now. And this song, if you've been in South Africa, or if you've stayed in South Africa, or if you're a South African, it will bring some emotions to you, right? And I want you to tell me, what does it say to you? So do you remember the song, right? Exactly right. Exactly right. So what emotions does it bring to you? Maybe this side? Okay, I'll start. Excitement. I don't want to work. I just want to do life. You know, this side, what emotions? Yeah, yes, it's World Cup, definitely. It was a 2010 World Cup for that 1 month. I would say it was a very odd month in our country. What does it do? Unity. Unity. Yes, yes, unity, definitely.
Sense of pride.
Of course. Liberty. Exactly. You know why I would echo that, right? I was saying that the last time that it was the only odd month in my life as a South African. The only month where there was zero crime statistics reported in the country, right? You know, I was like, where are the criminals? Are they sleeping? Guys, you should work. We've got tourists here. We've got cell phones. We've got, guys, we should work, right? I'm sure the KPIs were going to be quite high then. But no, it was a very good time. And we really enjoyed, right? So there was a lot of collaboration that came together, right? And so with the song, there's a lot of people working together. There's a producer, there's a video, there's a lot of people who are involved in that thing. But the whole point is for you to understand why you are doing it, understand your target market, as also understand how long you want it to be sustainable for, right? So a song is similar to our space, right? Be it the information security, cyber security, or data management space, we need to build lasting controls. which are agile, scalable, and can last with time. So I just want to play a song, right? Another one. This song is for the older generation, I suppose. But I can tell you now, even younger generation will be impressed by the song. They probably know it, right? Please play it for me. I can already picture my father there, right? With his Flohem shoes, thinking about that girlfriend who, by the way, is my mother now, unfortunately. You know, taking her to what's Chicken Licken in a Carlton Center, you know? You know, that was a very powerful song. Even today when I played it, like, in my days, I'm like, never. I was better than you, like, you, there's no way, right? So the song, I was definitely not a target market for this song, right? But I know it, right? I grew up listening to the song. Even today, when we play it, when we've got family functions, the mood just changes. There was a lot of thought processes that went into making this song, right? There was a lot of work. There was a lot of collaboration that happened there, right? The fact that we are still playing this song, and I can still draw those emotions from you, it means that there's a lot of work that happened there, right? I'm gonna play the last one, which is much more modern for the younger generation, and see if I can't extrapolate the same emotions. So, what I'm trying to say is, that song that I played earlier on, it was very powerful then. Even today, it's still powerful, right? It's got its own intended target audience, but the manner in which it was crafted and orchestrated, it made it to be timeless. I just played you the last one. It's a much more upbeat song, but it's an upbeat song, but similar, right? For it to be a hit song, to win records, that means there was a lot of people working together. So now, the question I'm gonna ask you is, how often do you consult? How often do you collaborate when you're bringing in your strategies? How long do they last for? Do they last for the next bonus? After you get your bonus, we can forget about them. No. Collaboration is key, and we should also be very important, very critical for us to know exactly how long we want our solutions to be sustainable for, as well as to know exactly what our problem statement is. So I'm here to bring in a new set of technology or evolution in the data management space and information security space. It's AI. So the question is, how can we use AI to augment existing cybersecurity? So AI and machine learning are modern day technologies that fuel digital transformation. So what we've got now, we just reinforcing it using technology. We are training the machines to think like I would think normally, but the advantage is that they never get tired. Unless obviously there's our famous load shedding, which we don't have control over, right? But they are constantly running. A robot never sleeps, right? Their deployment is dependent on the business flexibility and ability to adapt to emerging technologies. If you are still running on mainframe, I wouldn't really advise that you consider AI. It will be of worthwhile for you to migrate your data to a much more modern platform, right? To move to a data lake or even a cloud environment, depending on what use cases you are solutioning for. So if you look at the advancement, it also brings with its limitations to the existing cybersecurity controls. So starting with the threat hunting, it makes us spend more money in manually hunting for the threats. The scanning of threats, the scanning of the environment, you know, it becomes so manual and it's labor intensive and gets expensive. And most importantly, you must have someone who's watching that, right, overnight. It makes us to be reactive in terms of cybersecurity. We only respond after a threat has hit us. I mean, think about the situation in, was it Transnet? when they even declared a force majeure afterwards, twice, I think, already. You know, why? We need to be more advanced. I mean, look, think about the amount of money that we bring through the our point of entries, but we are still far behind. Geographical distance IT systems makes manual tracking a very tedious task, right? If someone is far off, unless you are closer, think about your regional offices, your provincial offices, you can service those ones better. But the minute you talk to an office in Kuruman, for instance, you can't. You probably are going to be saying, nah, maybe the threat level is low and whatever. But the fact that we cannot respond timelessly to that. And then hackers often hide and change their IP addresses. So you might find that we've got an incident, we activate our disaster recovery, but at the same time, you don't even know how to react to that, right? So again, with this, there's a lot of vulnerabilities, but mainly in the essence that our cyber adversaries are getting more aggressive. They are really, really attacking us. And the question is, how prepared are we as organizations to counter these threats? And how prepared are we to ensure that you integrate them in the digital economy that you are building? Another concept is digitalization, right? Which I think is spoken widely about, right? I'm digitalizing my processes. I know pretty much most of you are digitalizing, right? So there's a new concept now called RegTech. It has raised a lot of controversy in the media, but it mainly says use technology to meet regulatory requirements. Simple. I'm in compliance. I'm part of the data team. I'm part of the compliance team. So where do I fit, right? So I'm in the middle. So I use technology to overlay the controls. Think about POPIA, for instance. It says you must classify data. It says you must store it according to regulation, and you must delete the information 5 years after the end of the relationship. How else can you do that without using data? And you also need to ensure about AI will be able to help you there because of, you know, it's always thinking for you, right? And there's a lot of them. I mean, there's AI, there's blockchain, there's Internet of Things, and telecommunications of cars. So this here is also a success story. I'll make an exemption and talk about another bank just for now, right? Because I'm just, yeah, it's not great. But they had a very powerful case study. So they said, if you here, their principles, right? They can give you a full onboarding in, what, less than 5 minutes, right? With AML and KYC and FICA. And they can enable you to make an immediate transaction after that 5 minutes. And you can, obviously, which is transferring money. And every next day, someone is in your gate delivering the card. How efficient can you be? Wow. Although this is not a red bank, right? But I must say, I tested the systems, right? And halfway I was like, these guys are really doing their job. Then I ran away. You know, it's real. It happens. However, although it's advanced, this is what is making it possible. Look at those integrations. DSY, there's Home Affairs, all of these interactions that they've got, they are running very, very massive APIs at the back end, right? 94 interfaces, 120 plus minus connected systems. If I give you the job today, you're probably going to resign immediately, right? Where do you start? It is only through AI. It is only when you augment your cybersecurity to be able to manage such a platform. Of course, most of the data is virtualized. There's a little ETL or ELT that was done at the back end. Most of their data is probably sitting in the warehouse or in the legacy systems, so they are running APIs and visualizing the data, right? So they also have the feedback back to you on an app. So as you are sitting here as a customer, you can confirm what I'm talking about. You can go in there and just check if what I'm saying is true. But looking at what the situation has been post-pandemic, right? We're saying there's been an increase of 96% in terms of the successful phishing emails. So about what, 8 out of 10 companies. So that means we've probably been phished before, right? We get those emails coming to us. There's also more than 8 out of 10 respondents believe that their company is at risk due to inadvertent, slick, leaks by careless or negligent employees. Obviously, employees are very important stakeholders that we play there. And then what is, though, of significance is that only 23% of companies provide cybersecurity awareness training. 23%. So the question I'm asking is, if you are responsible for security, information security, cybersecurity, data privacy, data governance, how often do you conduct cybersecurity awarenesses? How do you ensure that they are enforced properly? Who do we target it to? It's a question I'm going to leave you to ponder on. And the facts that I've got in this study, my MCAT study, it says that the data thieves, obviously, they are winning. There are too many companies who are still cyber unprepared, which is a fact. We've seen that. And then AI and machine learning is giving cybersecurity a big boost, which is why we are saying it can do the job that I'm doing 10 times better than me, right? And then, but it's got its limitations as well because of fragmentation. Anyone who wants to maybe work with me, what is fragmentation? Any takers? What is fragmentation? If I'm seeing something is fragmented, what do I mean? All over the place, right? Do you agree with him? So our organizations are siloed, fragmented, and split up. And there's no need operationally for them to connect. That's why they are. But the minute you've got gaps in between the systems, you are creating a loopholes for cyber adversaries, right? So as an impact to cybersecurity governance, it makes it hard for us to govern cybersecurity if we've got fragmented systems. So there's new technologies for us to pull the information together, right? I'll talk to it now, but mainly the concept of data virtualization, right? You don't necessarily ETL the data upwards, you create a pipe. You're virtualizing it out, then you use an API to connect the integration. Then you can see on the consumption layer exactly what is on the sales. So you can combine all the source data into a visualization platform. But now, the way things are, we end up having weak perimeter security. We constantly have to be patching. You know, when you do regular patch management, you are really affecting the security. And for you to stay at least maybe stable, you just end up relying heavily on third-party vendors and then giving away your power, right? We call them strategic partnerships of vendors, but you end up giving away your power. So AI, augmented cybersecurity, is a branch of computer science that focuses on making computer science computers capable of tasks that humans only do through instincts. Simple as that. It is not there to replace me and you. I know the connotations of that, but it is there to automate repetitive tasks so that me and you can focus on moving businesses forward. That's it. Right. Of course, there's going to be responsibilities. I mean, I think the previous speaker spoke about upskilling and training. That is key. If you don't, yeah, whatever. But we need to take advantage for it to benefit us. So if you look into why we need it, right? We need it to augment the threat triage and prioritize the threat. Currently, when you're receiving a threat, what do? Do you immediately rush into the a war room and you stop everyone? You come there after 2 days, you're like, no, actually, it was a false alarm. It was not a threat. You've taken 2 days from people. That is what, 16 work hours. You've killed the business there, right? But an AI algorithm which is properly configured can easily do that for you without interrupting anyone. When you are sure that the threat is there, then you can pull your resources that you require. Or even use the same system to respond. It can also assist greatly in terms of supplementing the talent gap. I mean, the skills shortages is everywhere. We all know about it. And if you look at the ISIS squared, it says that if we wanted to meet the current demand, we need to increase our workforce by 145%. Are we really going to be able to reach this? Never. In a single year, by the way, right? And then it can also assist with what we are talking mostly about in the data space. We're talking about data democratization. If you're democratizing data, you're giving it back to the owners in business, but you need to ensure that it's secured for you to do that properly. Okay, so now I said to you, I'm going to just show you how to overlay AI augmented cybersecurity over a typical platform. So this is a typical architecture that we've seen before. On the top, I've got all the sources, internal and external. And then in the middle, there, I've got my integration layer. I've got my integration layer in the middle where I do my data cataloging, I do my mastering of data, data quality management, and then below that, we consume the data. So the question is, when you've got it like this, right, you can either deploy it at the external perimeters within the internal environment or what we used to call the DMZ before, but with an AI augmented, you can run it across the environment without paying money, and also only with running one algorithm or one role for this. And of course, moving your business forward, you can now start talking about secure data access management. So I'm going to wrap up now, colleagues, I'm looking at the time. But there's some elements that you require. You don't just go and say, AI, no. We need to be prepared. We need to prepare ourselves and get to a state where we understand what the direction of the organization is. The question I always ask people is, if I were to ask you, anyone, just give me verbatimly the business vision of your company that you're working in, unless you are the owner, obviously. Verbatimly, now. So you can't wake up every morning supporting a business that you don't understand their vision. Straightforward, right? So how are you crafting your solutions? They must be there to enhance the strategy. So there's a couple of factors, but mainly we need to operate in a flexible and an agile environment, which can play both in the cloud as well as in the prem environment, right? So once we've done this, obviously we need to have some success stories that we talk about, right? We need to have some things that we talk to and show that we are adding value, right? We're not just expensive for nothing, right? Because they always say we are too expensive. We'll be able to identify threats more quickly. I mean, if you can't, okay, maybe as a caution, if you can't measure a control, do not deploy it, especially when you are building a capability, because you need to show value. That's what agility means, right? You only pick those KPIs that you can measure and quantify them. To respond to threats more quickly, we can quantify that okay, last year we were taking about 5 days to respond to a threat, or no, 5 minutes to respond to a threat, but now we are taking 5 seconds. We've saved money, we've contained the risk as quickly as possible. It will also enable us to prevent attacks by automatically blocking suspicious activities because it can predict and look at the patterns, and it also improves the resilience of our networks. So, colleagues, in a nutshell, what I'm saying is, as much as technology has advanced, as much as we are seeing AI, robotics, machine learning advancing, it is also key that we also follow suit in the information security, cyber security, and data privacy space to ensure that we are on top of the game. Colleagues, thank you so much for your time. Back to you.